what happened in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's when he had captivity. Captive. He let him loose. And he had the confession to be in that other under. But in the under, what we call hell, what we call hell burning with fire and brimstone. But I said, man, what was that guy? They were in the fire. They were not chance. And the risk, and Lazarus was there. And Abraham says, I can see over there, but he can't come over here. The guy that treated me so bad in life, he can't come over here. Because there's a big separation between us since we left Earth. I'm standing over here, I ain't going over there. He can't come over here. So those guys, the people, so Abraham, Lazarus, and all those guys had to wait for Jesus to do his penalty pay at the price in him. Raise up out of the grave, raise up out of death, and then release them. Only opportunity to get alive.
That
man's up.
Back to these babies.
Back to these little tiny ones.
Now, you know, these little babies that's, I say maybe 2 or 3 weeks old, mm-hmm. they're born, and
that's
they died.
That's got it.
And you mean they not?
That's a place for them. In the afterlife, but provisions are made to where we should not all want to sleep. Last trumpet, twinkle in our
eyes.
Okay. An answer. They're not what we call experiencing salvation, but they're not born again. So little babies are coming to the world very selfish, going their way. And people that don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, the same way. It runs through all of them, that same nature. On my way, I'm going to cry, I'm going to kick, I'm going to scream, I'm going to throw something, I'm going to bite, I'm going to spit, I'm going to throw a tantrum, but I'm going to do the whole thing. I'm going to do the whole thing until I get out of there. And that's why the book of Leviticus was written, because that's how man died. We need training. We need instruction. You can't do that. Don't do that. That's how mankind works.
Acts 2:37.
They want, you know, so, you know, this is the question that we're dealing with that what was that question? How did you answer?
When they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brothers, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Okay, verse 39.
For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call.
So the promise, everlasting life and born again, is a promise to you. You got to get into believing. And what's up, everyone? Well, what should we do? We're told, you got to repent, and be baptized. And then you receive the remission of sins. So babies are born, that brings us into the reality. Babies are born, everybody is born with a, what? Sinful nature. And that's what that's why the book of Leviticus was written, because everybody was operating with sinful nature. Cause you to do selfish, only for me, only type stuff. Self-preservation is the strongest, they say it is. But I think now, once you're born again, you've got a different outlook on things. Self-preservation is one of the strongest instincts that mankind has. If you fly on an airplane and the mask drop out of the air, you got to take some action. And quick. What you going to do? Run around the plane, take care of everybody else, and you're going to run around the plane, take
care of everybody
else. Same as you are. This got you praying in the Holy Ghost. That mask coming. Guess who gets it first? Yeah, you better make sure you don't take yours. Take theirs, get my house. I got an extra one, just in case. The other guy just dying next to you. Oh, he needs one. Well, all the stewards, he needs a man. So self-preservation, I just won't catch on fire. Guess who's the first one out the window? Love everybody that gets down here first. So it's a built-in nature instinct that comes in, that comes with us. It's like the goose, the ducks got to fly south when it gets cold up here. They have no choice. They're going south. Ooh, why is that built in? What if it ain't so good? They have. So the same thing with us. People that are born of a sinful nature have some instincts built into them. It has to be trained out. And even babies come with it. They're the best ones to manifest this stuff. If you don't teach your kids, Sister Shirley, if you don't teach your grandkids the right way, well, what kind of teenagers are they going to be? Bad.
Terrible.
That's the way to train. They didn't get nothing instilled. So this is what God is doing with these beautiful laws. He's training, instilling them into it. Nowhere near everlasting life. Nowhere near being born again. He's putting this, instilling these things into them. Because it's bad. Okay? Now, because we got to take it in pieces. How you treat poor people. How you treat people who are not as well off as you. What? Take advantage of. Scriptures talking about poor folks, so we get into our lesson. Proverbs 22:2. First of all, question to the class again for another indictment. Did God make us poor? Did God make us poor?
No.
No. See that poor guy in the bread over there? What kind of God made him? All right. 22:2 says, is that what I said? 22:2. What happens to the rich and the poor? The Bible says the Lord is the what?
Maker
of them all. In other words, God gave life to everybody. God gave life to everybody. How do you learn up on this earth, rich or poor? You got to put people over that. But as far as giving you the breath of life, God gave it to you. Rich and poor. Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to give you a billion to get riches.
You gave you a billion to get riches, okay? How are we going to treat poor people? 2 Corinthians, go back to 6:10. This is us. This is our testament. How to behave around poor people. 2 Corinthians 6:10. This is our covenant. Okay. What did Paul say his attitude was? Super rich, but our life will enrich. We see it in other people. We give them to other people. It's a positive time. So any volunteers in here before we leave, volunteer. Do you have any more? Little League volunteers, Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, what's up? Girl Scouts, Girls, all
Rounds, Blueberries.
You saw into people's lives. You know, we see a patient. We help the kids show them white things. How to plant my fish. All this kind of stuff. How to make a campfire. How to keep them freezing in the cold. How to make a bed in snow. All this kind of stuff helps people out. Help the old lady across the street. The groceries. Open the door. Help the old neighbor's yard. Break the leaves. Help them crash into the curb. All this kind of stuff. Do you enrich other people's lives? You got time to help other folks, that's what Paul is saying. You are rich and poor into other people's lives. You don't have a paycheck, it's not a job, you just do it. Okay, so James 2:8, we'll probably need that again. James 2:8, this is part of our covenant. La, 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 la. All right, this is our foundation. says there, James 2:8, if you fulfill the law, according to Scripture, if you fulfill the law, according to Scripture, I shall do what? But, verse 9 says, but, whosoever shall keep the whole law, he's talking about a law. Wait a minute, we're New Testament folks. We got no laws. Yeah, we do. We do have some. Yeah, everybody's governed by something. But whosoever should keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is what? Guilty of all of the law. So these people in Leviticus are not telling them this right here. And you say, I treat the poor real good. Yeah. But I forgot something about that going to the temple. What was that? And he says, well, this is guilty in the whole. There's a lot of people out there doing good, but they got money, means, and they're philanthropy. How do you say that? Philanthropy. Won't put the shadow in a church building or with assembly of believers. Won't come close. I say, I'm doing good because I do all that. Just look at my work. It's all in the record books, public record, and all that. God is saying, oh, you're still guilty. You're still guilty. You don't come to church. You don't go to church. You don't assemble yourself with believers. So, not a verse we see in this post. But he's saying here, the only way you can keep the whole law is to have the nature of Jesus in your heart. So we're going to go back and look at, give some instructions to some not born again people. Now give this to them. All right. It says, when Shirley shall reap the harvest, Leviticus 19:1. And she go out to her farm and she's going to reap a harvest off of her land. Got a big crop out there. She should not pick up everything from the corners of the field. Neither should she gather the gleanings of the harvest. It's all hers. It's in her name. All 100% belong to her. When she goes out there with her donkey and mule and all these kind of folks out there wagging everybody, picking up stuff, she can't go to the four edges of her property and get that produce. And then when she's out there bagging up all that produce, and one drop out of her pocket, she can't turn around and go get it. Fell on the ground, you know. You go fishing sometimes, brother. One hit the ground and suddenly, you know, come off the hill, you know. Get that one. Send somebody back. Go get that one. Go get that one. Drop. God says, no, you're going to stay. Why? Because it's going to be somebody coming around who needs that. Who needs that? Went to the coffee shop the other day and paid Starbucks. I said, I got coffee. Starbucks. By my way to get to a Starbucks. Starbucks. Give me a tall pipe. Tall means short. Short cup of coffee. Here you go, $1.79. You for $2. Thank you, sir. Next customer.
$2.21.
I said, I get it. She took it and I heard her going to the tip jar. I was worried personally. Coming in there, I wasn't going to be fussing with my kids.
That's
a tip for that short. I said, all right. You know, that's how y'all roll over here. Yes. So, that's the same down here. When you go out to the corners, don't go to the edge of your property and pick all that in the corners. And right in the middle of the field, get all you can, and then as you gather it up, put it into the bags and all like that, so it can fall off on your way home, around that, let it stay. So that teaches us that why provisions need to be made for the poor. In our personal lives, in our corporate lives, provisions should be made for who? The poor. Remember the grace of our Lord, how he said is what? More blessed to do what?
Yes.
Is to receive. More blessed to be have made provisions for giving. Our folks don't make provisions. Had a change this week, someone changed McDonald's, I got it all. She's supposed to set something aside to help other people out. This is it's a law. It's, the law is called law of sowing and reaping. Sowing and reaping. And if you clean all your corners in your personal life, I mean, y'all, you go down to everything in your personal life. There's no provisions for nobody else but me and my house. You're not operating the law. So it
means. And form of today's deal. It's like we're if you know that you're going, you feel come back and cut it. They're good. Everything will be clean as if you see a little color.
That's right. That's right.
Yes,
yeah.
I think these are colors. Obviously they can figure it out.
Yeah.
Talking about
10, thou shalt not glean thy vineyard, and we just did that, so thou shalt not gather every grape out of it. Thou shalt leave them for the poor and stranger. I am the Lord your God. Now, I'm going to tell you like this because I know time's going to run out. The reason why he says, I am the Lord your God, is because he is saying that I got your back. I got your back. In other words, you heard him say, I am that I am in Exodus and all like that. He's, I'm whatever you need me to be. So I am that I am. And that's what he says. So I got you. Now, verse 11, you can apply Exodus 20 and 15 to it. We read it last week. Thou shalt not steal, neither deal falsely, and don't be lying on one another. That's so elementary, people. It's one of the things I had to do when I got saved.
I love
it.
It's elementary. But people still do it. Look at the Republicans and Democrats now. They will stand so right up and teach on front of TV with an ad. But they know it's not true. It's like, where are you coming from?
It don't mean nothing. I can say something this morning and say something totally different this afternoon. And aspire to both of them. So, that's one thing that... that's so powerful, ingrained in people, is to deceive and be deceptive. And you should not swear by my name falsely. I used to learn that as a kid. Neither should thou profane the name of the Lord thy God. I am who? The Lord. So people, I used to grow up around religious people, grandmother and all, and they said, boy, don't you can't say that. I didn't do it, I swear. I'm guilty as all. Yeah. I swear on a stack of Bibles.
Yeah, right.
Thank you. Swear. Okay, so now, how do you treat workers, people who work for you? One of my major concerns when I was in business for about 8.5, 9 years, my major concern was being able to be paid. That was my top priority issue. No matter what, I want to pay. No matter what. Somebody worked for you all week, you want to do what? Yeah, but we got all the time. Yeah, we do. But you know what? Pay orders. So that's what this next deal is all about. Is that thou shalt not defraud thy neighbor, neither rob him. The wages of him that is hired should not abide with thee all night until the what? Morning. If you're around business, you hear about all kind of ways businesses go out. Robbing pensions. Nowadays, it's going to rob people's pensions. They set up some kind of sophisticated way. But if the owner is taking it out of a payroll check and it's supposed to be forwarding, send it to the insurance company or wherever it's supposed to go, whatever entity, to stack away for that employee's retirement fund, where the employer gets into a crunch this week and he's gathering up from all 20, 30, 40 employees about another $2,000 to $3,000. Well, I'll just hold off on that and hopefully I'll get a profit next week coming up, and then I'll make up the difference. And then don't do it. Trouble starts. And the workers is trying to sue the employer because we didn't have no pension. What happened to you? There's not even a check. Jesus has something to say about that. That's between the neighbors. You hire somebody. Put somebody to work. Labor for you on your behalf. Leverage yourself against them. Let's see if that'll help us out a little bit. 20 and 8. Okay, so we might want to read verse 7 too, if you want to. Might be 27 and 8. Who's for it?
That they say unto him, because no man hath hired us. He said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that should ye receive. So when even was even, the lord of the vineyard said unto his steward, call the laborers and give them their hire, beginning from the least unto the first. And when they came that were hired about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny. But when the first came, they supposed that they should have received more, and they likewise received every man a penny. And when they received it, they murmured against the good man of the house, saying, these last have brought about 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and heat of the day. But he answered one of them and said, friend, I do thee no wrong. Did not thou agree with me for a penny? Take that thine is, and go thy way, and I will give unto this last
that has unto thee. Yeah, so very sense, what else we contract out to do? Do. I'm going to agree that I'm going to hire you for X amount of dollars. Yeah, but that guy worked. Okay, that guy only worked 2 minutes.
Let me be brief to you, man. If I made you do the same job, mm-hmm. I put it out for the car. I'm going to pay the same job. I'm supposed to get the same
job. I show payday. That's what you agree to. Here's the deal. We're talking now. Okay, I'm going to go to the right now. Women don't make as much as men. On the same job, doing the same thing. Go to the left. All right. We should get paid the same thing.
True.
We got the same job.
True. Do the same kind of work. True.
If I was in the board, and I said, okay, I got two XYZ vice presidents of merchandise. One's a man, one's a woman. Both of them got the same title. But one of them do the job a little bit better than the other. Oh, our employer likes one better than the other. Our employer just wants to pay more one than the other.
So does that mean that he get paid more because he's a little bit better?
Well, let's say here, and then I'll call them both in. I say, I'll tell you what, Miss Madam, I'm going to pay you X amount of dollars to do vice president of the church. You agree with that, Captain? Mr. Mayor, I'm going to pay you X amount of dollars. Same title, more money here. I don't know if you both realize the amount he's getting paid what, but eventually it's exposed. But nevertheless, we got a political situation here nowadays, and I'm going to say the employer has the right to call me S-H-O-T. Okay,
I'm going to say equal work for equal pay. Equal pay for equal work.
Okay, right? But
regardless of if it's a man or a woman.
If you agree to work for this amount, if you agree to work for this amount, then you will work when your work is done. That's what you pay.
If you agree. All right, but now the law, you brought the political stuff. Now, it is totally unfair. Same job, Brother Beauty and I are doing the same job, and I'm doing my job as well as he does his. We have the same title and everything. And all. It's unfair for me to get 77 cents and you to get $1.
Agree.
Yes. I'm doing the same job.
What does the scripture say?
Okay.
That's not a new word.
I'm
hired me, they told me I'm going to pay you this amount here, and that's what I accepted. So it didn't bother me because I was, yeah.
If you agree to that.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
See, I think what they're trying to do now is change the law because the law is unfair.
Well, I think
it's totally unfair.
I think the Republicans are saying it's up to the employer and that worker what they agreed to. You can't come in with the government and says you got to pay this vice president the same that vice president based on what the government says instead of what the employer is. That's their side of things.
Right. I wonder what the attitude and the discussion would be if the quorum was flipped. Men were paid 77 cents and women were not.
Just to be devil's advocate, the Republican argument is that it's up to the private sector, and which is the employer, how much I'm going to pay you and you and you based on what we agree. That's why unions came in.
And that's why the Republicans want the unions out.
Yeah. So that's why that exists. That's why that exists. But scripture says that whatever you do, what
will
you do?
And that agreement
comes
from people overlook on the application when they ask how much do you
That's right.
Do you expect desperation will say
anybody
put the Lord in every little amount of iron.
Thou should not go up and down as a talebearer. It's verse 16 that I jumped on. Thou should not go up and down as a talebearer among thy people. In other words, don't be a gossiper. Neither should thou stand against the blood of thy neighbor. I am the Lord. In other words, don't be taking people to court, not suing them and all like that, and you don't need necessarily to do that. Thou should not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. Let me go to verse 18. Thou shalt not avenge. A vengeance is nothing but an outward act of what's in your heart. That's what that is. And it's ingrained in us. That's a deep ingrained trait. If I go over there and beat up Sister Deborah, you think Brother Peter just would say, okay, brother, let's go to the bar and see the bar.
Exactly right. I think if you attempt to be
a
Sister Deborah,
because in the brain, first thing you want to
do, you'd be history.
Babies come, all this stuff is it's with us when we get here in this world, and these are the actions we want to take. But you got to have scripture and a law that says don't do that kind of stuff. Vengeance is one of them. Bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou should love thy neighbor how as thyself. If a stranger sojourn with thee in your land, you should not vex him. Yeah, hello, immigrants. Immigrants, Latinos coming into every community, just about anywhere. How you treat them? Neighborhood, living with you now on your same streets. Kids going to school with your kids. How you treat them? Those are illegal immigrants. Some governors say, rack them all up and throw them in the car and ship all out of here, babies. No, I don't care who gets left behind. Just get rid of them. Sometimes you hear these politicians and you wonder, what Bible are they reading? How do you treat strangers?
That's how
the Muslim.
If a guy come here we call him a towel or a towel over his head or something, sit next to you on a plane, let's first thing you
But that's how the argument on the workplace is you just came to play. Women were a stranger in the workplace. We didn't work at work, but
back
we
in
came
the 60s
in
there.
We were strangers at the workplace, and
but the strangers,
what's supposed to vex us.
Yeah. How do you treat strangers? White one is verse 34, that shall be with you as one born among you. And thou shalt love him as thyself, for you were strangers in the land of work. Egypt. You've been there. You know how it is being mistreated. You should do no unrighteousness in judgment, in wheat yard, in weight, or in measure. In other words, deal fairly. Negotiate fairly. Don't be cheap people, extra interest, extra this, or holding back this. Say, I'm gonna sell you this house, it's got two bathrooms in it, and you go in there and it only has a half of it.
Only one, but
it's carpeted. You go in there, it's not carpeted. It's got air conditioning. You go in there, and it's like, yeah, there's one in the window. I'm coming through the window. You know, so, selling cars, that's the biggest group get ripped off, selling cars. And, tell you the whole nine yards, it's this, that certified, this, that, got all that, and this and that, you get it, it's a clunker. Just balance, just weights, a just epoch, and a just head should you have. I am the Lord your God, which brought you up out of Egypt. Why is he saying I'm the Lord your God? Because he's saying, I got your back. You deal right, I got your back. I'm the all-sufficient one. That's what he told him about Exodus. I got all of this. I can do all of this for you. Don't worry about people cheat and steal and do self-restraints because they feel threatened that they're going to run out themselves. I want this guy to have it. That's how the baby is. And of course, so a 2 or 3-year-old, no, he's not saved. You got to put a rope on him. Watch it. You let him do anything. Just don't know. And I said, therefore, you should observe all my statutes and all my judgments, and then what? Do them. So, and this is what he had to do. Now, that was saved, so the Holy Ghost, do we need someone to tell us these things?
We don't need anybody to tell us because it's written, but it often helps to remind us because people tend to forget. Even in the book of Deuteronomy, it says, write them on the door for so that they will remember.
Okay.
It's written for anybody that understands. But we need to be reminded.
We need to be reminded. Don't steal, don't lie. Don't cheat. Yeah. Don't buy false witness. Don't swear by the name of the Lord. Don't cheat your name. That's what I'm saying. I need to hear this again.
Yeah.